General Abizaid is a classic example of an American patriot willing to serve his country for all the right reasons. He did not seek this nomination for attention or recognition. He was sought out by the administration because of his extensive experience and knowledge of the U.S.-Saudi relationship and the issues in the Middle East. He accepted President Trump's nomination because he knows at this point in time it is important to have someone skilled to navigate such a multifaceted relationship in this very important but challenging region. And yes, the U.S.-Saudi relationship is indeed complex. I know there is a lot of debate in this chamber on pressing foreign policy challenges in the Middle East as it relates to Saudi Arabia and Yemen and Iran, and I'm sure you'll ask him hard but fair questions. But here's an issue over which I think there should be no debate. We need a highly qualified ambassador in Riyadh, and we need that person there soon. I don't think there has been a nominee before this committee who is so uniquely qualified and well-equipped to manage the relationship of the posts for which he has been nominated. John Abizaid will serve his country as he always has, with integrity, honor, and distinction. I urge all of you to support his nomination and move to confirm him as soon as possible. Thank you again, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to say a few words about a great American.
Well, thank you very much. We'll hear from both of our witnesses in just a moment, but Ambassador Tueller, who's with us today, has been nominated to be Ambassador of Iraq, also a heavy lift. Ambassador Tueller is a career member of the Senior Foreign Service and has compelled multiple tours across the Middle East, has served his country with distinction as U.S. Ambassador to Yemen since 2014. His experience navigating the complexities of the ongoing Yemen conflict has afforded him a unique perspective on war and reconciliation, which will no doubt serve him well in post-war Iraq. Prior to his current role, he has served as ambassador to Kuwait as Deputy Chief of Mission in Egypt, Qatar, Kuwait, respectively, and as a senior diplomat in Iraq. Let me say just a couple of things as we open here. As far as Saudi Arabia is concerned, we have a shared security interests with Saudi Arabia in combating Sunni extremism and Iranian influence in the region, and we should not lose sight of that. At the same time, I think all of us have serious concern over events surrounding the Saudi kingdom. And the Saudi GCC rift with Qatar has made difficult U.S. efforts in the Gulf Arab unity against Iran. We look forward, Mr. Abizaid, to hearing, General Abizaid, to hearing how you plan to work with the Saudi officials to advance U.S. objectives on a wide range of issues, including Saudi's role in the Yemen conflict, the GCC crisis with Qatar, and reported human rights abuses. In addition to that, we welcome Mr. Tueller regarding the Iraq post. There remains ongoing tensions between Baghdad and the Kurds, as we all know, particularly in the north. Repairing this relationship needs to be a priority for the United States. The Kurds have been a good friend of ours, an ally of ours, and it's important that that the relationship in Iraq be repaired. This comes at a time when the Iraqi parliament is preparing to debate a resolution that would significantly affect the U.S. military presence there. This is a hugely concerning prospect, and I look forward to hearing from you how we can work together to communicate our shared security interest with officials in Iraq. With that, I'll yield to the ranking member, Senator Menendez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I just want to tell our distinguished friend and colleague, Senator Sullivan, from my travels abroad, I think it's the Marine detachments that actually, you know, protect the embassy. So I don't know if they want to hear that joke, but in any event, General Abizaid, Ambassador Tueller, thank you both for your past service, and thank you for both signing up to serve in two complex countries with which the United States has critical security partnerships. Mr. Chairman, I think it sends an important signal that these are our first two nominees before the committee in this Congress, especially since we have not had a nominee for Saudi Arabia in 2 years. And while we have had two closed-door briefings ostensibly touching on Saudi Arabia this Congress, they were wholly unsatisfactory in providing this committee with information. The administration's attempt to explain its failure to provide a legally mandated determination about the murder of American resident Jamal Khashoggi was insulting. I urge the committee to hold open hearings with the administration to understand our actions and our objectives. And specifically, Mr. Chairman, I ask you to work with me and the other bipartisan co-sponsors on this committee on the Saudi Arabia and Yemen Accountability Act. If the President fails to act, I believe Congress must. Now to our nominees. You will both face challenging environments. General Abizaid, as we discussed, Saudi Arabia has taken a number of actions that have seriously strained the U.S.-Saudi relationship over the past few years, actions that belie the ambitious reforms many had hoped for. Under new management, the Crown Prince has launched Saudi Arabia into a devastating war in Yemen, isolated Qatar, threatening Gulf cooperation and coordination against threats from Iran and regional terrorist groups, detained and tortured members of his own family, effectively hoodwinked and intimidated the Lebanese prime minister. And just this week, we publicly learned about the detention and potential torture of a United States citizen. And I'd like to acknowledge that a member of Dr. Fatahi's family and his advocates are here today. Amidst all of this, we continue to cooperate in confronting real and strategic threats to the United States and Saudi interests. The kingdom does continue to face legitimate threats, including from Houthis, often with Iranian backing. No country should be expected to live with the threat of missiles being launched into civilian centers across its border. But as the conflict drags on, violent Houthi factions only become more empowered. We cannot let these interests blind us to the values or to our long-term interests in stability. I have been disappointed with the administration's public posture towards Saudi Arabia. Our leaders cannot credibly call on the world stage and demand accountability for human rights abuses while giving a wink and a nod to the Crown Prince. General Abizaid, while I'm wary of the militarization of the State Department, I believe you have the right experience for the kind of leadership we need at this embassy. As we discuss, you will face not only the challenge of engaging directly with the Saudis and managing a large mission in Riyadh, you'll have to contend with a White House that at times seems to be running its own bilateral show. Ambassador Tueller, given your current service to Yemen, stationed, however, in Riyadh, as is the ousted Hadi government, I'd also posit some of these challenges to you. As our ambassador to Yemen, you have been responsible for securing U.S. interests there, for supporting an internationally led effort to promote a political solution that offers legitimate security interests for Saudis and Yemenis, while also ensuring that all Yemeni people have a political process to express their interests, one that equitably and adequately addresses all equities and promotes our interests. You'll face somewhat similar challenges in Iraq. Unfortunately, the President's lack of a coherent strategy for U.S. policy in Iraq has only increased some of the challenges we face. As we discussed yesterday, there's a growing movement within some political corners to oust American troops from the country. I believe we have invested too many American lives in national treasure, seen too many Iraqis perish under the brutality of terrorism, and risk critical alliances that we have built to do that precipitously. We must work with the Iraqi people to continue to support building institutions, to promote an inclusive political process, and continue training Iraqi security forces so that the Iraqis themselves can ultimately defend their country. We must support efforts to confront those seeking to continue destabilizing Iraq from a resurge in ISIS to Iranian political ambitions. And I'm particularly concerned about the proposal to permanently close the consulate in Basra. Your job will be to keep an open mind about the political process, finding a way to include Shia, Sunni, and Kurdish populations with whom all of which the United States has important relationships. And in that context, I look forward to hearing from both of you as to your testimony.
Thank you, Senator. Gentlemen, thank you to both of you for willing to take this on. As both myself and the ranking member have stated in our opening statement, we've tried to tee up for you to answer some of the questions that are really challenging. About everybody that comes here, we talk about the challenging conditions in the country they're going to. Both of these are very, very unique challenges. We hear a lot of talk on this committee from the administration, from the media, from all the opinion writers about the problem of reconciling the United States' interests in having a strategic relationship with Saudi Arabia and reconciling how we're going to do that while at the same time, as the ranking member pointed out, Saudi Arabia has engaged in acts that just are simply not acceptable. And unfortunately, as I said, we hear a lot of descriptions about the problem. We don't hear any answers. There have been some modest suggestions that have been made, none of which would resolve the problem, I don't think. It is an ongoing conversation that the ranking member and I are having, and that we're having internally amongst this committee, sometimes publicly, sometimes privately, and likewise between the committee and the administration. So we're knowing that you don't have a silver bullet or a magic answer, we do want to hear your thoughts, your comments, analysis, and maybe even some helpful suggestions as we go forward, because everyone agrees we've got to go forward and reconcile these two very competing things. Iraq is not totally dissimilar, but again, the kinds of things that are going on there that make it very difficult for us to operate. But it is essential we have a relationship with Iraq, and that that it be in the best interest, has to be in the interest of both countries, or it won't be a relationship. So, gentlemen, thank you, and we'll start out with you, General. Why don't you take the floor?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Menendez, members of the committee. Thanks goes to Senator Sullivan for a very overrated introduction. He is a smart Marine. He is a great Marine, and he's a great senator, and I value his service to this nation so much. Thank you, Senator Sullivan. I also want to say how privileged I am to be here with Ambassador Matt Tueller, who served in so many tough and demanding assignments. I'm honored to appear before you today as President Trump's nominee to be the next U.S. ambassador to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. I am grateful to the President for his nomination and to Secretary Pompeo for his trust and confidence. I welcome the opportunity to discuss the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and ask that my full testimony be submitted for the record. If confirmed by the Senate, I pledge to work closely with the members of this committee to advance U.S. interests and values in Saudi Arabia and the region. My wife Kathy and my son David are both here today. And my daughters, Sherry and Christy, have duties far away, but they are here in spirit. I thank the family for their love, their support, and service to the nation. All of the kids have served the nation, and my son-in-law, Lieutenant Colonel Rob Shaw, continues to serve as a battalion commander of paratroopers. We have spent too much time in the Abizaid family dealing with America's wars. It is my hope that if confirmed as ambassador, I can play some small role in ensuring that my grandchildren never see combat in the Middle East. Having served for a considerable part of my life in the Middle East, I am aware of both how difficult this region can be and just how essential it is to U.S. interests and national security. It is my conviction that stability in the Middle East is most endangered by the continued threat of violent Sunni extremism and Iran's radical policy of Shia expansionism. From Syria to Yemen, these forces foment instability, deprive the region's people of a better future, and threaten the national security of the United States. It is difficult for me to imagine today that a convoy of Iranian Revolutionary Guards Quds Force, filled with weapons, could travel unimpeded from Iran to Lebanon. The good people of Iran deserve a better future than the endless war and constant drain on the economy provided by the IRGC Quds Force. To confront these threats, the United States must work with and through our regional partners. We cannot effectively combat these threats nor promote our core interests and values without them. The United States has a long history of cooperation with the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. It is difficult to imagine a successful U.S. effort to undercut Sunni extremism or keep Iran in check without engaging and partnering with the kingdom. This is not to say that I am unaware of the challenges facing the U.S.-Saudi partnership today. war in Yemen, the senseless killing of Jamal Khashoggi, rifts in the Gulf Alliance, alleged abuses of innocent people to include an American citizen and female activists, all present immediate challenges. Yet, in the long run, we need a strong and mature partnership with Saudi Arabia. Reform there promises to make the kingdom more dynamic, more prosperous, and the region more stable. It is in our interest to make sure that the relationship is sound, to assist with the vision of reform, and not shy away from expressing our views and our values to our partners in the kingdom. If confirmed as ambassador, I pledge to work tirelessly on the many issues that will inevitably come between the United States and Saudi Arabia. It would be my great honor to lead our diplomatic team in Saudi Arabia to advance U.S. interests and values in the kingdom and to counter the forces that threaten U.S. national security. I am grateful for the opportunity to appear before you today, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Tueller.
Chairman Risch, Ranking Member Menendez, members of the committee, I'm honored to appear before you today as President Trump's nominee to be U.S. Ambassador to Iraq, and particularly to be here along with General Abizaid, with whom I've had the privilege of working before in the region. If we're both confirmed, I look forward to a close and collaborative relationship as we both seek to advance U.S. interests in this important region. I'm grateful to President Trump and to Secretary of State Pompeo for their confidence in me. If I'm confirmed by the Senate, I pledge to work closely with the members of this committee to advance U.S. interest in Iraq. Mr. Chairman, as we begin, I ask that the full written text of my testimony be submitted for the record.
It will be.
I'd like to recognize and express great appreciation to my wife, Denise, who is here with me today and has provided steadfast support throughout my Foreign Service career, including during periods of separation when I served at unaccompanied posts like Iraq and Yemen, and during periods where she and other U.S. Embassy family members were evacuated from posts in Egypt and Saudi Arabia. Along with our five children, Denise and I have had the privilege of representing the United States abroad under many challenging and rewarding circumstances. Two of our children are also here today, David and Margaret, as well as our daughter, Ayai, and two of our grandchildren, Yuna and Jin Tueller. I would not be here today without the love and support of my family. Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Menendez, members of the committee, I'm grateful for your consideration of me to lead one of our largest diplomatic missions in the world. If confirmed, I'll draw on my leadership and policy execution experience in the Middle East. Our relationship with Iraq remains a critical one for the United States, and if confirmed, I'll do my utmost to advance U.S. interests there. Let me stress from the outset, there's no greater priority for me than the safety and security of all Americans, whether residing in the homeland or in the Middle East and in Iraq. Our longstanding principal objective is to bolster Iraq as a sovereign, stable, united, and democratic partner of the United States. We must remain engaged to ensure that Iraq can fend off the internal and external threats, including threats from Iran, to its sovereignty and its territorial integrity. Our determination to see Iraq as a pillar of stability in the Middle East stands in stark contrast to Iran's agenda, which seeks to exploit divisions, weaken state institutions, and foster extremism. We cannot turn a blind eye to Iran's interference in Yemen, Lebanon, Bahrain, Syria, and of course, Iraq. Iran and its proxies threaten our interest and the security of our friends and allies, including Iraq's Sunni neighbors and Israel. Iraq's most pressing need is for continuing assistance that reinforces the primacy of the Iraqi security forces, strengthens their capabilities, and deepens their professionalization. Together, we must be vigilant to prevent the return of ISIS or the emergence of other terrorist groups. Our coalition-wide approach to stabilization in liberated areas sets the conditions for more than 4 million internally displaced persons to return home. What much work remains to ensure the remaining 1.8 million remaining internally displaced persons are able to safely and voluntarily return to their communities and rebuild their lives. The work of our coalition is not over. We and our partners are there at the invitation of the Iraqi government, with 24 other countries helping Iraq ensure its gains against ISIS are lasting. This coalition must continue to assist the Iraqi security forces as they combat a growing ISIS insurgency. If confirmed, I will work hard to boost our commercial and economic engagement with Iraq and to provide new opportunities for U.S. businesses and to help Iraq develop its economy to meet the challenges that are growing more acute. If confirmed, another priority of mine will be assistance to Iraq's persecuted religious communities that ISIS targeted for genocide. I will emphasize the priority we attach to the safety of these communities, and I will support continued U.S. assistance to these groups and will work diligently to promote prospects for their survival in Iraq. To fully stabilize, Iraq also needs to move toward a vision for national unity in which all of its communities play a part. Iraqi nationalism remains a potent force, and Iraqis are proud of their ancient heritage and culture. ISIS and other unhelpful actors want nothing more than to divide and weaken Iraq. We, on the other hand, will continue to support a strong and independent Iraq. The administration believes that a strong Kurdish regional government within a unified and federal Iraq is essential to Iraq's long-term stability and to the enduring defeat of ISIS. We're proud of our long-standing and historic partnership with Iraq's Kurdish people. Senators, if confirmed, I look forward to the support of this committee and an ongoing dialogue to together serve the interest of the American people. Thank you for the opportunity to testify, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you very much. We're going to proceed to a five-minute round of questions. I'm going to reserve my time, and I'm going to yield to the ranking member.
Thank you.
Opening questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both for your testimony and to your families, because they also share in the sacrifice. General Abizaid, we talked a little bit about in the office. The administration has a habit of communicating with foreign governments, including foreign leaders, outside of traditional diplomatic channels. How do you plan to exercise your authority as chief of mission? Will you insist on remaining fully informed and briefed of all White House and administration officials' interactions with the Crown Prince and other members of the Royal Court?
Well, thank you, Senator. Yes, I will insist upon that. And I am also an old soldier, and I know my chain of command. My chain of command is the President and through the Secretary of Defense, or Secretary of State. Freudian slip, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Understandable.
I also will join with the many interlocutors that will come out from Washington and from other places in our country and talk to them, because I think it's hugely important for me to explain what's going on in Saudi Arabia from America's point of view and to give a point of view and an opportunity for them to see what's going on.
And I raise the question because it's very difficult to be the ambassador, the chief of mission, and have someone else from the outside said, you don't have to listen to that, just listen to what we tell you. And that would be an impossible, even within a chain of command, that's an impossible way to operate. So I hope you'll assert yourself, if confirmed, as our ambassador there, while working with others, but nonetheless assert yourself as the chief of mission. I don't think I need to tell you that Congress has become increasingly concerned over the Saudi-led coalition conduct in Yemen. This isn't to absolve the Houthis of their own abuses, but we don't sell arms to the Houthis. They're not a legitimate nation state with whom we share diplomatic relations. Repeated stories of U.S.-supplied bombs hitting weddings, funerals, and school buses are simply unacceptable. The administration's apparent prioritization of arms sales over fundamental values is not acceptable. So I have found this so incredibly challenging that I have placed a hold on a series of offensive weapons sales to the Saudi government, pending complete verifiable information from the State and Defense Department about how the Saudis are using American-made weapons. Can you speak to me about how you'll address this issue if you're confirmed, as well as what will you say to the Saudis about their continuing engagement in the Yemen conflict?
Thank you, Senator. I think it's very important that the Saudis find a path towards peace in Yemen. It's in their interest. It's in the interest of the government of Yemen. It's in the interest of the region. It's also important that in the peace that is found, it is not found in such a way that there is a Hezbollah-like militia that is underpinned by the IRGC Quds Force that is able to operate freely in a free and independent Yemen. As far as competence in the operations conducted by the coalition there. I think they have much work to do. It's very important for us to continue to talk to them about the targeting system, about the way that they go about hitting the various targets, about the professionalization of the forces, and that when mistakes are made, that they do like we do, which is convene a board of officers, talk about the mistakes, and then take the corrective action necessary to gain better and better expertise. I'm hopeful that there is a way to move forward with regard to easing the humanitarian problems of Yemen, and we will continue, if I am confirmed, to tell the Saudi government the need to do so.
I appreciate that. Our goal is ultimately to end the conflict in Yemen, and I hope that you will move the Saudis in that direction. Let me, in the last seconds that I have, get a series of yes or no's from you on these set of questions. We have seen alarming reports of both Emirati and Saudis transferring serious U.S. origin weapons systems to third-party fighters on the ground. Will you engage with the Saudis to have them understand that we do not accept their transfer of our weapons that we sell to them to others?
Yes.
Will you continue to press the Saudi government to fully account for the murder of Jamal Khashoggi?
Yes.
Would you ultimately commit to ensuring that if the administration moves forward, which I don't think it has, and I know Senator Markey is very interested in this, in any type of civilian nuclear agreement, that we move towards the gold standard?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Senator Rubio.
Thank you both for being here. In general, thank you for being willing to take. I actually think this is the toughest assignment in the world right now in our diplomatic corps. Saudi Arabia, as you well know, is an important strategic partner on combating terrorism, on confronting Iran. They also are our most difficult partner right now because it almost asks us to agree to stay silent on grotesque violations of human rights, both domestically and abroad. And their crown prince is not making things easier. He is increasingly making it untenable. He is reckless. He's ruthless. He has a penchant for escalation, for taking high risks, confrontational as foreign policy approach, and I think increasingly willing to test the limits of what he can get away with the United States. Anyone who thinks that's an unfair assessment of the young man should look at what he's done in the last 2 years. It seems like something out of a James Bond movie. He's kidnapped the Prime Minister of Lebanon. Kidnapped the Prime Minister of Lebanon. He kicked out the ambassador of Canada, canceled flights to Toronto, cut off investments, recalled all their students in Canada over a tweet or a couple tweets from the Canadian foreign minister regarding human rights. And he's fractured the important alliance with the Gulf kingdoms. He's obviously, we know, ordered, I believe, and all the evidence I believe strongly indicates he ordered or knew of efforts to murder Jamal Khashoggi and to do so in a third country in a diplomatic facility. By the way, domestically, he's ruthless. We know of the case of Saif Badawi, who's been sentenced to 10 years in jail and 1,000 lashes for blogging. And then we have the case of women activists, upwards of 11 at one point, but who have been brutally tortured and mistreated, whipped, beaten, electrocuted, sexually harassed in the basement of what some call the Palace of Terror. And then we have a United States citizen, a doctor, Waleed Fatahi, Harvard-trained physician, who recently was slapped, blindfolded, stripped to his underwear, bound to a chair, shocked with electricity, all apparently in an effort to get him to provide evidence against a family friend or a relative through marriage. And then reports as recently as yesterday and today that the families had their home raided in retaliation for family members here in the U.S. who have had the audacity, according to the Saudis, to come to Capitol Hill and tell the stories of their family members. And then, of course, to top it all off, which is of great shame to an American company, you have Google and Apple, but apparently Google's already made this decision. There's an app in Saudi Arabia called Apsure. Here's what it translates to roughly. It's called Yes Sir. That's the name of the app. Here's what it allows men to do. It allows them to see where the women under their watch are. It allows them to cancel their passports. It allows them to look at their travel and flight logs. Google says that they're going to keep selling it because it doesn't violate their terms of service. We're still waiting on Apple. I mean, it's just stunning. Anyway, the point being is, I guess I've given all this to you. I guess that's the bad news of this assignment that you've agreed to take on, to great credit to you. But how do we balance this? How do we balance all of this with this important regional and strategic partnership? Because this guy's making it harder. He's gone full gangster, and it's difficult to work with a guy like that, no matter how important the relationship is. And welcome to the committee.
Yeah. It's a great honor to be here, Senator Rubio. Senator, I appreciate your concern. There are many difficult problems. I would like to make the current problems short-term problems, and we work quickly to try to fix them to the best of our ability. Our relationship with Saudi Arabia is bigger than a relationship just with the Crown Prince. It's all about a nation. It's about a government. It's about a king. It's about the oil minister. It's about many, many nodes of people that are interested in moving the kingdom forward in a better way in the 21st century. And so I think that as I move forward and learn more about the kingdom, and I want to emphasize how much I respect the kingdom and the people there, I will look for every way possible to find out what has gone on in the short-term problems and enhance the need to make the long-term problems work. Arab societies, and Saudi Arabia in particular, have many nodes of interest. These nodes of interest need to be engaged by us in order to find out ways to move forward and solve these problems.
This is an aside. One of the things that I think will come up during your time there is what's already been mentioned about the potential for a nuclear agreement. You know, Senator Markey and I recently introduced legislation to increase congressional oversight over any civil nuclear cooperation agreement or 123 agreement. Secretary Pompeo's already said he wants a 123 agreement, which would not permit enrichment. And I just strongly encourage you to be a strong voice in that regard, because someone who has a penchant for recklessness, who has a penchant for escalatory foreign policies, and all the other things I've highlighted, to retain the capability to enrich would be, I believe, an incredibly dangerous precedent to set. And I don't know how you serve there for 2 years or longer and not run into this issue at some point, because I no doubt think it will become a prime issue here very shortly.
I appreciate that issue, Senator, and I had failed to acknowledge the issues concerning women's rights. I have two daughters and a wife. I will be very interested in helping in the reform effort to move the rights of 50% of the population there forward in a way that brings their talents and energy to the surface.
Thank you. Senator Shaheen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And let me welcome both you, Mr. Tueller, and you, General Abizaid, and thank you for being willing to consider taking on these difficult posts at this very important time. I would like to begin with you, General Abizaid, and add my support for everything that Senator Rubio said, and add one more concern to that, and that is that the United States still is owed $331 million from Saudi Arabia for air refueling that we provided the coalition in Yemen. I think the list of human rights violations is so long, it's hard to comprehend what's going on there. And I would like your assurances as ambassador that you will consistently raise the issue of human rights violations in a way that expresses to the Saudis the grave concern that we have in the United States about what they're doing.
I will, Senator.
And can you talk about how, as ambassador, you can, what opportunities you have to help hold the Saudis accountable for what they're doing? It has been 2 years since we've had an ambassador in Saudi Arabia without any oversight or concerns expressed on some of these issues.
Senator, ambassadors don't hold countries accountable. Countries hold countries accountable. It's the role of the United States to ensure that the Saudis know what we stand for, what we believe, and what the relationship needs to be to move forward. I will ensure that those ideals, those values, those mutual interests are conveyed as clearly as I can to the government of Saudi Arabia. And I look forward to working with them, not in an adversarial way, but in a way that promotes our ability to have the partnership move forward that makes the region more secure.
And I know that several people have mentioned the Khashoggi murder. Under the Global Magnitsky Act, there is a responsibility for the administration to respond to that murder. Can you talk about what responsibility you might have as an ambassador to try and ensure that the administration is responsive under the Global Magnitsky Act?
Yes, Ambassador. The Secretary of State has said on many occasions that we demand transparency and accountability. Yeah. It seems to me that we will continue to do that throughout. We probably don't have all the facts. We need to get all the facts, and I will convey them to the best of my ability to the Secretary and to the National Command Authority and to this committee.
Thank you. Ambassador Tueller, one of the challenges that we have heard from the Iraqis in response to our continued presence there is the differences of opinion among the Iraqi people about our continued military presence in Iraq. As ambassador, how could you help address the concerns that the Iraqi people have?
Thank you, Senator. Our military presence and the presence of other coalition members is there at the invitation and request of the Iraqi government. I believe there are many, many of the Iraqi political leaders, but most importantly, Iraqi military leaders who want that presence there. They understand the importance that that presence provides to enhancing their capability, to providing training and support. So I think we need to rely on those friends, those who understand the impact that our presence has, and use that leverage to make sure that that's an enduring contribution to Iraq's security.
And one of the principles of this new policy with respect to Syria is the assumption that we can continue to support the Syrian Democratic Forces in Syria with the forces that we have in Iraq. Do you have any view on how successful that kind of policy can be?
So in both cases, I think we face similar concerns about the security threat, whether it's the resurgence of ISIS or the role that Iran or other outside actors play in fomenting instability. It's always been my belief that our presence in the region, our engagement, whether it's diplomatically, militarily, economically, serves as a stabilizing presence in the region. And of course, our presence in Iraq, I think, has importance beyond just the borders of Iraq and signals to any potential threats that we are there and prepared to defend our interests.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I'm out of time, but I hope that you will address the role of Iranian influence with the new Iraqi government at some point in this hearing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to start out by thanking the nominees and their families for their past service and sacrifice and for your future service and sacrifice. We are faced with some stark realities, reality that we don't particularly like, but ones we have to deal with. Senator Rubio was talking about, I think, the way I like the way he termed it. We were facing a crown prince that's gone full gangster. We find the behavior completely unacceptable. But at the same time, as you said in your testimony, General Abizaid, we need a sound relationship with Saudi Arabia. The reality is that Iran is the malign influence and needs to be countered. So I'd like both of you talking about how, because you mentioned in your testimony, but take a little bit more time. How important is our relationship to have a sound relationship with Saudi Arabia vis-a-vis Iran? General Abizaid.
Thanks, Senator. How important it is, it's a vital national interest that we have a sound relationship with Saudi Arabia to counter malign Iranian influence. And I think it's important for all of us to recognize the difference between the Iranian people and the mullahs and the IRGC Quds force that control the security apparatus of Iran. It's my view that sooner or later, the good people of Iran, which are many, will get tired of the violence and the drains on their treasury, and will start to move towards a better future. It's essential that as this happens, reform in Saudi Arabia moves apace. Saudi Arabia is the linchpin. It has been for a long time. It will continue to be. And I am confident that if we face our problems with them squarely and not mince any words about it, that we'll be able to solve them.
Ambassador Tueller, let me ask you the question slightly differently. What are our alternatives? If we don't have a sound relationship with Saudi Arabia, where do we go to from there?
Senator, I think it's sobering to imagine the region without that important security relationship between the United States and Saudi Arabia. One of the main differences between Iran and Saudi Arabia, in my view, from the perspective of the U.S. diplomat, is Saudi Arabia wants us in the region, wants us engaged in helping to address the region's underlying problems. Iran and its proxies want us out of the region. They see that their agenda is served by having the United States disengaged out and not countering their malign influence. So I think it's very, very important that we work to ensure that that relationship with Saudi Arabia allows us to continue to project our influence into the region.
None of us like the situation, the reality that is in Yemen right now. You're currently the ambassador. In my office during our meeting, one of the questions I asked you is, because we're all counting on a peace process, and we all say, you know, military solution, we have to have a peace process. But realistically, what incentive do the Houthis have to agree to a peace process?
Senator, I hate to begin the answer to any question with saying it's complicated, but of course Yemen is complicated. Even the Houthis, I don't think, can be viewed as monolithic. There are elements that currently are aligned with or fighting with the Houthis out of ambition, of self-interest. Northern tribes or elements that are still loyal to former President Saleh. I think as we continue to apply pressure to them, what I hope is that we can create conditions where some of those elements will begin to abandon sort of the Houthi ideological project, a project that, because it's an Iranian project really in Yemen, will never bring stability to Yemen. You're absolutely right, sir, that there's no way that the Houthis are going to voluntarily give up their weapons and just become part of a power-sharing arrangement. So we need to continue to apply military, economic, political, security pressure on them.
Let's face it, Iran has no incentive to pressure the Houthis into some kind of a settlement, right? They would prefer a failed state in which they can operate and continue to spread their influence. So, again, that being the case, absent military pressure, there's really no way we're going to come to a peace agreement, correct?
Sir, I think that's correct. I would point out, of course, as I speak of Iran, and I'm sure as you do, we're really in many respects talking about the IRGC, goods force, a malign element. I believe if the people of Iran came to understand that their government is spending hundreds of millions of dollars in Yemen, a country far from their borders where they have no strategic interest, while they're suffering economic hardships, that perhaps the voice of the Iranian people can help to bend their policy towards something more constructive.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador.
Thank you, Senator Johns. Mr. Tueller, your comments about the sobering thought of us not being aligned with Saudi Arabia in the region and being gone from Saudi Arabia, I think is very insightful. Having said that, I think that the message needs to be strong, and I'm sure General Abizaid will carry it, that they're making it very difficult for us right now, and the Crown Prince particularly is making this very, very difficult for us. And there are boundaries, and that's a real problem. It is a serious problem, and it's going to have to be addressed by the Saudis and by the Crown Prince. Thank you, and it is Senator Murphy's turn.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both for your willingness to serve. I hope we get you to your posts as quickly as possible. Thanks to your family as well. Even those of us who have been the longest, most vocal critics of Saudi Arabia don't wish for us to walk away from what is an incredibly important relationship, an important counterterrorism relationship. Saudi Arabia has played a role for good in the detente in the region between Israel and the Gulf states. But the relationship today is just completely upside down between the United States and Saudi Arabia. If you knew nothing about the history of this country, the history of Saudi Arabia, and you watched the conduct of this relationship over the course of the last year, you would get the impression that Saudi Arabia is the great power and that the United States is a dependent junior partner. After the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, the Saudis didn't come here to explain what happened. Our Secretary of State went there to do a showy photo op. The person in the administration that seems to be in charge of the relationship is someone who has absolutely no history with respect to foreign policy in the region. The reason why so many of us think that it is necessary for us to take action to reset the relationship is not because we want to walk away from it, but because we need to put ourselves back in charge of this relationship and make clear that the way in which we have been treated and our residents have been treated is unacceptable. That being said, General Abizaid, I want to turn to a slightly different part of our relationship. We do have this important counterterrorism relationship with Saudi Arabia, but as has been said, Saudi Arabia historically has been both a firefighter and an arsonist when it comes to the fight against terrorism, in that they certainly apply pressure on the most radical elements in the region, but they also have exported a version of Islam that forms the building blocks of extremist movements, a conservative, intolerant brand of Salafist, Wahhabist Islam that they talk about wanting to control, but still seem to be spending a lot of time pushing money out into the region and into the world. You've written about this. You've given a lot of thought to this. How do you predict approaching this sensitive issue as ambassador?
Senator, it's a very thoughtful question. The time that I spent as the director of the Combating Terrorism Center at West Point gave me an opportunity to look at this pretty deeply. And at least I can report to you, based on my last visit out there, that the situation is getting better. And while we spend a lot of time talking about what the Crown Prince hasn't done or what he has done that is malign, we should also say that he has sent a very clear message that he favors a more tolerant view of Saudi Wahhabi Islam. And I see evidence of that. It's not just him, of course. It's the whole country that wants to move forward. The young people want to move forward. They're happy not to see the religious police on the streets. They're happy to be able to have the opportunity for women to drive, but it can't just be a PR issue. It needs to be a deep societal change issue. And I believe that the country's leadership is committed to that. And we need to help them move forward to the extent that we can.
The locking up of women dissidents is not necessarily a great advertisement that you are willing to push a more tolerant version of Islam, but I appreciate the fact that you have spent time thinking about this, and I hope that you continue to work on it. Ambassador Tueller, I wanted to ask you one specific question because you have been on the ground as our chief diplomat in and around Yemen for the last several years. Reports emerged a few months ago that our coalition partners, the Saudis and the Emiratis, had transferred American weapons to AQAP-linked fighters in Yemen. And in fact, in the wake of these reports, the UAE admitted to having done as such. Let me ask you, when did the administration, when did you learn about these transfers?
Mr. Senator, of course, I saw the same press reports recently that you'd seen. I believe we all saw back in 2015 some similar reports that there had been some weapons transfers. I know that CENTCOM and DOD is investigating this, trying to track down exactly where and when there might have been unauthorized transfers. In the case of weapons that we had earlier provided to the Yemeni security forces back in 2010, 2008, we know that some of those weapon systems probably have fallen out of the control of Yemeni legitimate forces following the Houthi-led coup
And what are the consequences of that?
So we all understand absolutely and take very seriously the use of end-use monitoring of our weapons transfers, and we expect countries to whom we transfer weapons to adhere very, very closely. And we don't just expect that. We follow up with systems to make sure that we can track and hold countries accountable.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Well thought out, Senator Murphy. Senator Romney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member Menendez. Thank you, General and Ambassador, for being here. Thank you in particular for a lifetime of service to the greatest nation on earth and to the cause of freedom. The sacrifice that you have both made in very different ways, but an enormous sacrifice, putting yourself in harm's way and in danger, often being gone for long periods of time from your loved ones and the country of your heritage, is most commendable, and I feel it's an honor to be with you, and an honor to have you willing to serve yet again in a place of great challenge. As we contemplate the outrage of what is occurring in Saudi Arabia and what has occurred there, as we contemplate the extraordinary harm and pain and suffering of civilians in Yemen, and we consider much of what goes on in parts of the Middle East, there is sometimes a sentiment amongst our members and amongst the American people to say, why are we there? Why don't we just leave? Why don't we just get out of the Middle East and let the Sunnis and the Shias and the Iranians and the Saudis do what they're going to do, and we'll just stand back in our hemisphere and just not worry about it? That's not a sentiment that I share, but I'd be interested in the moments we have to hear from both of you as to why we're involved in the Middle East and why we're involved in Yemen, what the significance is of those things for the citizens of the United States. Mr. Tueller, why don't we begin with you?
Thank you very much, Senator. In the case of Yemen, the United States has important interest. We want to ensure that there are no terrorist groups that can arise in Yemen or use the territory there to mount attacks against us or our friends and allies. We want to make sure that there's freedom of navigation through the strategic waterways around Yemen. Much of the world's trade passes through the Bab al-Mandeb, and of course to contemplate that Iran or a hostile power would be able to control that, I think is of great strategic interest to the United States. We want to make sure that our friends and allies in the region have secure borders, that they don't feel that they're being threatened by groups like the Houthis that can act on behalf of Iran as armed proxies in these countries. And then, Mr. Senator, there's another important interest, I think, that as Americans we have, and that is the humanitarian situation. We don't give in to hopelessness. We don't give in to cynicism. I think all of us react the same way when we see pictures, whether it's in Yemen or other parts in the world, where innocent civilians are suffering as the consequences of war or the actions of irresponsible governments. So as the United States, we have an interest in mitigating that humanitarian challenge. One of the things that I often feel badly about is because we have the relationships with Saudi Arabia, and understandably we hold them to a higher account, we do focus on the consequences of Saudi actions in terms. But almost 100% of the humanitarian catastrophe in Yemen has been caused by the Iranian-backed Houthis that overthrew the government, destroyed the institutions of the state, caused approximately a 40% decline in the GDP of the country. I see very, very little reporting, for example, of the millions and millions of mines that the Houthis have planted around the country that, in fact, have caused more civilian casualties and will continue to cause civilian casualties going into the future. So that's a great concern, and I think the American people need to be concerned about the humanitarian issues. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Romney. Extremism and sectarian violence is the curse of the Middle East. And extremism, unfortunately, isn't just a curse for the people in the Middle East, it's a curse for all of us. Recently see what happens when an extremist attack happens between two nuclear armed powers like India and Pakistan. We have a responsibility to do our best to help the people in the region keep extremism from gaining the upper hand. When I think back to the days of the ISIS offensives not far behind us, it was terrifying to me to think of the idea that Iraq could become an ISIS-dominated state. Extremism requires constant work on the part of the good people in the region, and the United States helping people help themselves to defend themselves against it. As long as Iranian state-backed Shia extremism and ISIS and Al-Qaeda-type extremism on the Sunni side exist, it's important for us to stay engaged. And it's important for us to move in a direction that allows the people in the region to have a better future so they don't fall prey to the extremist narrative of lies. When I think about the future of the region, if countries can reform, if countries can embrace their own populations, there's a chance for a much better path ahead. I do not, by the way, believe in large presence of American forces in occupation. It's counterproductive to getting the job done. Let's help the people in the region help themselves, and in particular, in the case of Saudi Arabia, their counterterrorism activities in conjunction with our own have been very, very meaningful in putting somewhat of a damper on the extremism that we see so frequently throughout the region.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Romney. Senator Kane.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and congratulations to each of you. You're very, very well qualified for these positions, and I appreciate your service. General Abizaid, I'd like to start with you. Jamal Khashoggi was a Virginia resident. Family lives in Virginia. And I want to raise up another individual who's has a Virginia connection, just to exemplify the human rights challenges that I hope you will grapple with as ambassador, Aziza Al-Yusuf. Aziza Al-Yusuf is a legal permanent resident of the United States. She came to Richmond to study computer science at Virginia Commonwealth University a long time ago, got a computer science degree, moved back to Saudi Arabia, and is a Saudi citizen who has taught computer science in Saudi Arabia to women for nearly 30 years. You have brought wonderful families with you today. She's a mother of five. She's a grandmother of eight. And she passionately believes that women should be treated as equal human beings. She has been engaged in the protest about women being able to drive. She's been very active to try to reform and end the guardianship system that essentially makes women surveil the property of a man. She's been very active in protests with respect to lax treatment of domestic violence by men against women, all while raising her family and teaching computer science in Saudi Arabia. She was imprisoned in May with a group of women and men who had been advocating for the right of Saudi women to drive. She was imprisoned after the driving restriction was lifted, and the interpretation of that by most has been, when the driving restriction is lifted, we want to send the message, you have no rights, we're giving you a privilege. But by then imprisoning all the activists, men and women who had been advocating for women's equality in driving, it was essentially a message to everyone, you cannot protest, you have no rights, we're doing this as a privilege. And Amnesty International and other organizations indicate that Aziza Al-Yusuf and the others who have been in prison have been tortured, held, they can see their families once a month. This is a grandmother of eight, a mother of five, who spent her whole life educating Saudi women to be computer scientists. And I just will say, General Abizaid, this is an important relationship, but for me, it's sort of a proxy of a nation's authoritarianism, extremism, corruption, if they treat women the way these women are being treated, for simply advocating that they should have basic equal rights. And so you have the background to do this job and do it very, very well. But I hope the human rights aspect of the portfolio and the treatment of these individuals who have ties to the United States will be a top priority for you.
Senator, you have my word. It will be.
Thank you. To Ambassador Tueller, is Iraq an ally?
Sir, I think that the relationship between Iraq and the United States is an extremely important one that serves both our interests. And so I think that I've outlined some of those common interests, particularly in security in the region. And I expect that while I'm there, I'll be able to continue to work with Iraq as a partner and ally of the United States.
Thank you for that. And I share it. I think we're partners. I think we're allies. There's a lot of work to do to make that relation strong. As you pointed out, we are in Iraq militarily now at their invitation. We're not occupying Iraq. We left militarily in 2011. With the rise of ISIS in 2014, Iraq has asked us back. And even if there's some controversy about that with some, politics is not going to be a slam dunk on any issue. Overwhelmingly, the Iraqi government still wants the United States to be there to be that kind of partner. Wouldn't you agree?
I think that we can count on Iraq to continue to want the U.S. involved. They understand what happened after the U.S. forces withdrew back in 2011, that a rise of ISIS controlling over 55,000 square miles in Iraq, this deeply, deeply traumatized and threatened Iraq, and they understand that they need the assistance of the United States and other partners to avoid the resurgence of that threat.
General Abizaid said a powerful thing at the beginning of his testimony. He said the Abizaid family has spent too much time in the Middle East, and you don't want your grandchildren to be there at war in the Middle East. It's interesting that Iraq is now an ally and a partner, and yet we still have two authorizations for military force against Iraq that are pending. President Trump said in his State of the Union, great nations don't wage endless wars. I think great Congresses shouldn't authorize endless wars. The 1991 Gulf War authorization to go after Saddam Hussein for the invasion of Kuwait is still live and active, kind of a zombie authorization floated out there. It's never been repealed. The 2002 authorization to go after the government of Saddam Hussein is still active and live, again, kind of a zombie authorization out there that has not been repealed. Senator Young and I have introduced today a bill to repeal both the first Gulf War and the 2002 Iraq authorization. There's no need to have an authorization against an ally and partner, and I would hope my colleagues might see the virtue in cleaning that up. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Kaine. Senator Paul.
Thank you both for your testimony and for your service. It's often said, I'll direct this to General Abizaid, it's often said that, you know, Iran is the largest state sponsor of terrorism, said over and over and over again. I think it's often forgotten, though, that I would say Saudi Arabia is the largest state sponsor of radical Islam. They act in somewhat different ways. Iran is very much a regional player, and they're involved anywhere there are Shia populations, and they're very much involved in several theaters, mostly within the Middle East. Saudi Arabia's malign influence, though, is worldwide. Most of the extremists that we've seen have been Sunni extremists. The Saudis fund tens of thousands of madrasas, including tens of thousands just within Pakistan. It is said that people trained in these madrasas cross the border and actually attack our soldiers and have killed our soldiers in Afghanistan. And so when I hear people say, oh, they're getting better, they're letting, you know, women drive, part of me thinks, well, maybe that's a public relations stunt to let women drive while we imprison the activists at the same time. At the same time they're letting women drive, they're sending a team of thugs with a bone saw to chop somebody up in another country, a writer and a resident of our country. So I don't think we should be fooled. But I do think in the larger context of things, the reason I bring up sort of Iran and Saudi Arabia is it reminds me somewhat of the Cold War, where anybody that sided with us, we turned a blind eye to human rights violations. So there were dictators throughout Africa, Mobutu, Mugabe, who did horrific things to their people. And we just looked away. They said, well, they're our guy. You know, they're on our side against the Soviet Union. So we've divided up the Middle East. Iran's the largest state sponsor. And we never say a thing about Saudi Arabia. We're starting to because of this horrific murder. But I think we turned a blind eye because of oil, because they tend to side with us against Iran. And I just think there needs to be a more even-handed look at this. Not saying that Iran is good, but maybe both are malign actors. Also, when we look at the Middle East, I think there needs to be someone saying, you know, we talk about a Middle East peace process, and we're, you know, it's all been about the Palestinians and Israel. I think that's an important question, maybe an imponderable one. But I do think that really, the big peace process would be someday somebody recognizing that it would be having Saudi Arabia at the same table with Iran if you really want to solve most of the Middle East process. So I guess my question to you is, given all of that, do you think we need to make a stronger statement about the Saudis instead of just saying they're getting better, saying, well, you know, perhaps we need to restrict the arms sales until they quit funding madrasas. Instead of saying, please quit funding madrasas, maybe they should have to quit funding madrasas. We should play hardball with our weapons and say that people that you know, imprison people and give people 1,000 lashes and all the things the Saudis do, maybe they don't deserve our weapons. General Abizaid.
Thank you, Senator Paul. I already indicated that I think extremism is a curse of the Middle East, and it's extremism on the Sunni side and it's extremism on the Shia side. And really, sectarianism is the twin curse of the Middle East, and we have to move very, very hard to convince the good people in the region to abandon forms of extremism. But when I think of extremism in Saudi Arabia or extremism in any other Arab country, there are elements within the population that believe that if they fund extremist preachers, if they fund extremist ideologies, if they fund jihadis to move to the sound of the guns wherever the current battle might be, that they are doing God's work. And it is clearly not God's work. So we have to keep saying it. It doesn't matter whether it comes from Saudi Arabia or Egypt or the UAE or Yemen. We've got to keep saying it. We've got to keep working against it. I will not shy away from that. I have
that.
Told them that for years, and I will continue to tell them that. But on the other hand, I would also like to respectfully say they have made progress. I remember having an opportunity to go to Saudi Arabia recently where I saw some very innovative and very effective programs aimed specifically at reducing terrorism, both financially and on the field of battle.
I appreciate that. Ambassador Tueller, President Trump has often said that the greatest geopolitical blunder of the last 20 years was the Iraq War. What is your opinion on that?
Well, sir, I think that the removal of a leader like Saddam Hussein from the region in the long term serves the interests of the United States and stability.
Do you disagree with the president?
I don't think the president, I can't take his remarks.
Well, his point was that removing Hussein created a vacuum, created endless war over there, and also empowered Iran.
It's empowered many of those forces of sectarianism and extremism, but I think in the long term...
Which goes back to Senator Kaine's point, are they an ally? Some would argue Iraq is now more of an ally of Iran than they are of the U.S. But the president disagrees with you. The president thinks the Iraq war was a big mistake, emboldened Iran, and we shouldn't have done it.
Thank you, Senator. We will move to Senator Merkley.
Thank you very much. And Ambassador Tueller, when you were commenting on the humanitarian situation in Yemen, you said virtually 100% of the humanitarian problems are caused by the Houthis. I found that very surprising statement. Extensive number of deaths are being caused by a cholera epidemic that comes from the Saudi bombing of water systems. The United Nations did a study that said of 17,000 civilian deaths between 2015 and 2018. The majority, 10,000, were the result of the Saudi-led bombings. Can you explain a little bit how you reached the conclusion that the Saudi bombing of civilians somehow is not responsible for 0% of the humanitarian crisis in Yemen?
Senator, I think the death of civilians in conflict is unacceptable, and we should always...
That's not my question.
Well, I think that we want to... we cannot excuse that. However, my remarks about the Houthis being almost 100% responsible, there's an anecdote that I often relate to people. In January of 2014, the most important port in Yemen used by the private sector was the port of Aden. It had 111 ships that disembarked during that month of January 2014. In January of...
Mr. Ambassador, could you speak up, please?
In January of 2015, which was before the Saudi-led intervention, but after the Houthi takeover of Sana'a, the number of ships disembarking in Aden had fallen to 9. Now, that was almost 100% responsible for the Houthis' actions that caused foreign investment, the Yemeni private sector to flee the country to stop investing in that economic activity.
So I don't want to use all my time on the lengthy explanation there, but when you say that if 100% is the Houthis, 0% is the Saudis, you are giving them no responsibility for having used their munitions to attack civilian sites in Saudi Arabia, and I find that very astounding.
Sir, when we have seen cases where the Saudis have caused collateral damage, we've spoken very, very forcefully to them about that. We've worked to try to mitigate those consequences. We've seen improvements.
Okay,
but the UN has...
By acknowledging that, you're saying there is some Saudi responsibility. I'm going to have to stop there.
Yes, sir.
I did find that very disturbing, given the vast deaths caused by the Saudi bombing campaign, and to treat the Saudi Arabia as saying, oh, they're our ally, so we'll blame someone else for all these deaths they're causing, seems unacceptable to me. General Abizaid, we have really been disturbed in Oregon by the Saudi Arabia posting bail for Saudi citizens and then those citizens disappearing. In 2016, Mr. Nora, a Saudi national, killed a 15-year-old Portland native driving approximately twice the posted speed limit. Saudi Arabia posted bail, and he disappeared. And we had the Saudi consulate post bail for Mr. Al-Hamad, who fled Oregon before facing trial in 2012 on multiple sex crime charges, including rape. We have a Saudi national, Mr. Al-Wais, who's faced charges in 2016 for striking a homeless man with his vehicle, who disappeared. We have the Saudi consulate posting a $500,000 security deposit for Mr. Al-Harti, a student in Oregon and Saudi national, who was arrested in 2015 on 10 counts of encouraging child sex abuse before fleeing the country. We have the Saudi consulate posting $500,000 bond for Mr. Duwais, another university student and Saudi national who was arrested in 2014 on the charge of rape. We have these crimes being committed by Saudi nationals, and then the Saudi government posting bail and whisking them out of the country. Is this acceptable?
Certainly not acceptable for any government to assist their citizens that have violated our laws.
Are you as disturbed as I am that essentially at this moment the Saudi nationals in the United States have a get out of jail free card that allows them to commit abuses against children, manslaughter, rape, and have no accountability?
Senator, I think there has to be complete accountability for any government and their citizens living abroad, and that means respecting laws of the host nation. I would, in fairness, like to point out that there are 80,000 Saudis studying in the United States, most of whom are not the type of people you talked about.
And believe you me, I'm not implying that Saudi nationals as a whole are committing crimes on a higher basis than anyone else. I don't have that statistic. I'm making the point that when a person commits a crime in the United States, we shouldn't, because they're an ally who buys a lot of stuff from us, allow them to whisk their citizens out with no accountability for rape, for child abuse, other sexual crimes, manslaughter, or for any other crime. And my sense is you agree with that.
I agree that any government that assists their citizens fleeing our justice is breaking our laws.
I know, and you're translating this into a general principle, but aren't you disturbed by these exact issues regarding Saudi Arabia?
Well, what I can't say, because I don't know, I accept your stories, but I don't know that the government assisted in the escape.
Well,
I just don't know that.
Yes, what we do know is that it has been the conclusion of our government that they are likely to have assisted, and in one case, at least, the passport was surrendered. And so something magical happened for the person to be able to return to Saudi Arabia. I've introduced the Escape Act, which calls on the State Department to analyze this issue, to report on it. If five cases happened in Oregon that we know of, and there may well have been more we don't know about, there may have been hundreds of these cases across the country. I'm surprised that the State Department hasn't already investigated this. I just would you encourage the State Department to investigate this issue and get to the bottom of it? And if this is happening with other nations, then investigate that too. But the ones we have knowledge of all involve Saudi Arabia.
Senator, if you confirm me, I will encourage them to do so.
Thank you.
Fair enough. Thank you. Senator Young.
Thank you, gentlemen, for your lifetime of service. By my reading of your many accomplishments, I think you come in well prepared to not only be confirmed, but to serve our country honorably and professionally. Mr. Ambassador, I have a follow-up question pertaining to this issue of the Houthis, the Iranian-aligned Houthis being the primary driver of the humanitarian crisis, which may indeed be the situation right now. They have mined the ground. They've been responsible, by my latest briefings, for numerous violations of human rights law. But I think it's helpful that we remember recent history. Over the last couple of years, our Saudi partners working with the Emirates and the United States of America, who have assisted with refueling, targeting assistance, military training, and some other activities, has also been party to some actions that, per my many briefings on the subject in classified and unclassified settings, has helped to radicalize portions of the Houthi population, leading to their alignment with the Iranians when many would not have otherwise aligned with the Iranians. They have blocked the port of Hodeidah, where 80% of food, of medicine, of water is delivered. They have the bombing campaigns where they have indiscriminately bombed civilians. Is something that I hope moving forward we will continue to recognize, help to exacerbate what remains the worst humanitarian crisis in the world. Yes, the Saudis must remain security partners. They will be complicated partners moving forward, especially with their current leadership and their crown prince's impulsive and sometimes reckless behavior. Reading of this United States senator. So I just think it's very important that we're reminded of this and are sort of sober-minded as we continue to try and finesse this relationship. Senator Shaheen earlier brought up the lack of responsiveness that we've seen by the administration under the Global Magnitsky Act. General, I remain frustrated by the administration's unwillingness to follow another law, specifically the National Defense Authorization Act in Section 1290, which my colleague Senator Shaheen and I worked on. There's a provision in Section 1290 which requires the Secretary to certify that the governments of Saudi Arabia and UAE are undertaking a number of actions. The provision also includes a detailed requirement for Yemen-related briefings to Congress and requires the administration to submit to Congress a strategy for Yemen. I have not yet received, Congress has not yet received a credible certification from the administration. I don't intend to remain silent on this. This is the law of the land, and I want it to be followed. So, General, would you commit to providing myself and other members of this committee a monthly update on the following? A description of Saudi Arabia military and political objectives in Yemen and whether the United States' assistance to the Saudi-led coalition has resulted in significant progress towards meeting those objectives. A description of efforts by the government of Saudi Arabia to avoid disproportionate harm to civilians and civilian objects in Yemen. An assessment of the need for existing secondary inspection and clearance processes and transshipment requirements on humanitarian and commercial vessels that have been cleared by the UN verification and inspection mechanism, a description of the sources of external support for the Houthi forces, including financial assistance, weapons transfers, operational planning, training, and advisory assistance, an assessment of the applicability of the U.S. and international sanctions to Houthi forces that have committed grave human rights abuses, obstructed international aid, and launched ballistic missiles into our Saudi partners' territory, and an assessment of the effect of the Saudi-led coalition's military operations in Yemen on the efforts of the U.S. to defeat AQAP and the Islamic State. General, would you commit to providing that information on a monthly basis to this committee?
Thank you, Senator Young. As a citizen of the great state of Nevada and not a member of the administration, I have nothing to say about that. If you confirm me and I become a member of the administration, I can commit to assisting the administration in answering those questions.
I thought you'd answer somewhere along those lines. Well, let me just note before yielding back to the good chairman that if the administration is not already tracking each of the different things I've requested of you, it would be a matter of sort of diplomatic malpractice, security malpractice from my perspective. And it's my fervent hope that the administration will follow the law and finally provide a credible certification as required under the law. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Senator Cruz is next.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you both for your service. Congratulations on the nominations you received, but thank you also for being willing to serve. Neither of the countries to which you've been nominated are easy postings, nor are they altogether safe postings. And so we are grateful for both of you answering the call to serve your nation in challenging times. General Abizaid, I want to start with you. Saudi Arabia is, in my judgment, a deeply problematic ally. Their human rights record has been sorely lacking. They have, for many years, been willing to fund jihadists on the principle that if you feed the crocodile, perhaps it will eat you last. Their conduct with regard to Mr. Khashoggi was abominable and unacceptable. On all of those fronts, I think we should be clear and explicit condemning their actions. At the same time, they're nonetheless an ally. And critically, they are a vital counterpoint to the nation of Iran. And as I look to the Middle East, the rivalry between Iran and Saudi Arabia, any conduct that the United States Congress does to weaken Saudi Arabia vis-a-vis Iran, to my mind, is harming the national security interests of America. Because a stronger Iran with an Ayatollah Khamenei pledging death to America, funding terrorists actively trying to murder Americans, a stronger Iran makes for a more dangerous world. Do you share that assessment, and what role do you believe Saudi Arabia plays in counterbalancing Iran?
Thank you, Senator Cruz, for the question. I certainly share your sentiments in your description about Iran. Maybe 15 years ago, maybe, I would have shared your description about Saudi Arabia. There was absolutely too much turning a blind eye towards extremists leaving the country and causing problems elsewhere. As I look at it today, I don't think the problem is solved, but I think it is getting better. There are joint task forces for combating terrorism. There's joint task forces looking at the economic flows of money into the terrorist networks. We notice here recently that Hamza bin Laden was stripped of his citizenship, that others have been forced to pay a price for their support of terrorism to Al-Qaeda, ISIS, or indeed even supporting the Iranian state. So it is incumbent upon the United States to continue to press the case that good allies do not support terrorism anywhere.
And can you describe the importance of a strong Saudi Arabia as a check to Iran?
Senator, I think you did an adequate job of that. I don't know what I could add.
Is there any coherent or rational argument that Saudi Arabia poses a comparable threat to the United States to that of Iran?
Senator, when I look at the reform vision of 2030, if we can support it moving forward, it's a plan for diversification of the economy. It's a plan to begin the empowerment of women. It's a plan to make the armed forces more professional. It's a plan to give the young people of Saudi Arabia a hope for a better future. If that plan can succeed with the support of the international community, I believe we will see a change, an important change, that will be good for all of us in Saudi Arabia.
What do you believe Iran is trying to accomplish in the Middle East?
You know, Senator, we've had this conversation before, and I appreciate we've had it. And as we've noted before, I firmly believe that the good people of Iran are just putting up with the IRGC Quds Force and the Mullah government. Given the opportunity for a better future, just like the Saudis, if they had a vision for a reform movement, if they had a vision for a better future, the people would move in that direction. But right now, the IRGC Quds Force and the radicals are in charge, and we need to keep the pressure to cause them to ultimately be deposed by their own people.
I agree with you. Ambassador Tueller, one of the more troubling developments in Iraq has been the growing influence of the Iranians, both Iranian Shia militia and also direct or indirect Iranian control of the Iraqi institutions of government. How significant do you assess that threat, and what should we be doing about it?
Senator, I think it is a great threat. It's one that concerns us, and I know it's one that concerns the Iraqi people. I think one of the most powerful forces in Iraq, leaving aside the sectarian influences, ethnic differences and political parties, is Iraqis share a strong sense of pride in their Iraqi Arab identity. They do not want to see their country weakened, divided, sovereignty impinged upon, and they see the major threat of that coming from Iran. So I think as we empower Iraqis to build the kind of country and future they want, that's what we have to build on.
Okay, final question. Talk to me briefly about the Kurds. The Kurds have been loyal allies. They have spilled blood supporting the United States of America. They have, I think, been neglected and mistreated far too often by United States foreign policy. Can you talk about the importance of assuring that we don't abandon the Kurds once again and leave them subject to the predations of their neighbors?
Senator, that U.S. Kurdish relationship is a historic one. It's a long-lasting one. I think it's a very important one. I intend, if I'm confirmed, to make sure that that relationship between the United States and the Kurdish people is one that's solid, that gives the Kurds the sense of security they need, that they're never again in the future going to be dominated by the type of regime that Saddam Hussein represented in Baghdad. At the same time, I think it's very important from the U.S. perspective that we see good, solid relationships between Baghdad and Erbil. And I intend to do all I can to make sure that that relationship is a positive one.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Cruz. Senator Gardner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both for your service to this country, your willingness to serve in these new posts. This country truly is grateful for your service. General Abizaid, continuing on the conversation you had with Senator Cruz, there are certain issues, resolutions that this Congress may be voting on regarding Yemen and other resolutions. How would that affect or change relationships in Saudi Arabia, perhaps empowering Iran, if you could talk a little bit about that?
Senator, first of all, I'm sorry we missed our appointment. I understand you were snowed in badly in Colorado.
United once again proved they are in charge.
Senator, it's a good question, and I don't think it is good for me as a private citizen at this point to comment on legislation. I would prefer to say it is very important for us to set the stage that allows for reform in Saudi Arabia, that allows ultimately someday for reform in Iran, and that allows for a better solution to the many problems that are transparent and obvious in Yemen. One thing we can't afford in Yemen, we can't afford to withdraw U.S. expertise to the coalition about how to fight. If we want them to fight right, we need to continue to give them that expertise. Another thing we can't afford is that a Hezbollah-like pro-Iranian IRGC Quds Force militia were to form in Yemen. It would be a lethal threat to the region and one that we couldn't ignore, and certainly one that Saudi Arabia couldn't ignore. So it's important that we work in the right way in your legislation, and I know you are. But again, I think me commenting about exactly how it should be done would be out of my place.
In general, and you may have already talked about this with other members of the committee, I apologize if I'm repeating, could you talk a little bit about the civilian nuclear agreement and what parameters ought to be in place to assure a true civilian nuclear agreement, if that is indeed the case?
Well, Senator, I've had this discussion with many of you in our consultations. I certainly think that in some future there can be nuclear power in Saudi Arabia, but I think any time the U.S. provides nuclear power to anybody, it needs to be done under the strictest controls possible.
With the standard gold-plated agreements that have been in every...
I would say, yes, that's certainly the standard, but the issue is all about let's not allow plutonium or other type of weapon or ever other type of substance move to somewhere where it can be used as a bomb.
Right. Thank you. Ambassador Tueller, we discussed some of the challenges in Iraq, obviously, with corruption. How does the United States proceed addressing government corruption and how, you know, the tools that you could bring to the position?
Senator, our engagement, and whether it's through advocating for U.S. businesses to be present, to competing for contracts, and the responsibility and the transparency that U.S. companies bring when they're engaged in an economy. Also, I think continuing to empower the Iraqi institutions that have been stood up, that so far have been able to continue to exist within the new Iraq, that are intent on promoting greater transparency. The issue of corruption throughout the region, and in fact through many developing countries, is one that as U.S. diplomats, when we encounter, we see how toxic it is. And I think the U.S. government, by upholding our standards, by encouraging greater transparency, help the citizens of those countries.
What effects do you see remaining from the separation of the referendum, the decision, of the, or the attempt last year, I believe it was last year?
So between the Kurds?
Yes, and, correct.
Well, of course, the call for a referendum, we opposed that. We advised many of the Kurdish leaders that we thought it was provocative and unnecessary. What I am pleased to say is that we're seeing that relationship already improving. I know that there's good relationship between the Kurdish leaders, the current president, and the current prime minister as well, and that some steps are being taken to repair that damage and put the relationship on a better footing.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Gardner. Senator Udall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to both of the witnesses here today. Appreciate your testimony. These first two questions are for both of you. Last fall, Ambassador James Jeffrey, the State Department Special Representative to Syria, stated during a Defense One conference, and I quote here, "It requires stability ops to break Iran's meddling influence," end quote. Jeffrey continued saying that Iran, quote, "will create a new Daesh if we don't get at the underlying problem," end quote, referring to an Arabic acronym for ISIS. This is an odd position given that Daesh is a Sunni terrorist organization. In tackling Iran, he said, "We have no better partner than Saudi Arabia." He added, "We couldn't be doing what we're doing in the region without them." Yet we know that funds from Saudi Arabia, donors, flowed towards Daesh and that many Wahhabi clerics were an inspiration to ISIL's leaders. Saudi Arabia has also been implicated in the murder of Jamal Khashoggi and is directly responsible for one of the worst humanitarian disasters in recent history in Yemen. Comments like these and those of Secretary Pompeo and President Trump last year trying to frame Iran as a supporter of al-Qaeda and other Sunni terrorists without proof should get our attention. Just last year, Reuters reported, in announcing the U.S. withdrawal from 2015 Iran nuclear deal, Trump said in May that Iran supports terrorist proxies and militias such as al-Qaeda, end quote. In a speech last week, Pompeo said, quote, today we ask the Iranian people, is this what you want your country to be known for being a co-conspirator with Hezbollah, Hamas, Taliban, and al-Qaeda? In the same report, Reuters noted that a study cast doubts on these claims. Claims, if true, would give the president some legal argument to say that the 9/11 AUMF applies to Iran, a claim that I, as a member of Congress who voted in favor of the 9/11 AUMF, find to be without any basis in reality. My first question to both of you is, do you believe that a war with Iran is in the best interest of the United States or either of the countries you are nominated to serve in?
No. No, Senator, I do not.
Do either of you believe that the 9/11 AUMF extends to Iran or that Congress intended to use the 9/11 AUMF to take on Iran?
Senator, I would have to defer to the State Department legal advisor to address any issues about authorized use of military force.
I would have to defer to the legal experts because I don't have any expertise in the issue.
Yeah, well, you guys were both around when all of this happened, and you know how targeted we were with the 9/11 AUMF and what our objectives were, which we long ago have achieved. So I find that a little discouraged that you're punting on that one.
Well, Senator, I guess I would say is I was a soldier, and we go where you tell us to go.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I understand that, but you're also a very smart gentleman. You understand the realities of the Congress. It's Congress that has the authority under the Constitution to declare war, and it's also Congress that if it decides to do so and it thinks it's appropriate, that ends wars. And so an AUMF that's been in place since 2001 and is being used around the world as the reason for going into countries, I think, is something you should be worried about as a soldier and something that you should have looked into. So anyway.
Thank you, Senator.
We all know that climate change is real and that the result is that in places like New Mexico and Iraq, there is less water for all to go around. We must adjust to this reality. There are real and persistent water challenges in Iraq, including the Mosul Dam, and lack of sufficient drinking water supplies and trained staff to manage these important infrastructure investments. What role can the United States play, and what role can you play to help facilitate a sufficient water supply in Iraq, including Mosul Dam stabilization, so that the region avoids conflicts over water resources?
Senator, it's an excellent question. It's one that applies in Iraq. It's one that I've seen come into play in Yemen, which faces depletion of its water resources and elsewhere in the Middle East, in Syria and elsewhere. So throughout the Middle East, you often find that the water resources are underlying as part of the ongoing conflict. So I think it's important with respect to the Mosul Dam. The United States, through the Army Corps of Engineers, has been involved in some of the efforts to try to stabilize the dam. The Iraqis themselves are taking on a greater responsibility for that. It's a tremendous threat, one that we all need to remain vigilant. So thank you for the question, Senator.
Thank you. General, do you have a thought on that?
Sir, I would only say, Senator, that the water problems in the Middle East are great. And the number one thing we can do to help solve them is first get these conflicts under control to the best of our ability. Yeah. Once we do that, then other things will follow.
Yeah, well, I hope we can do that, and then I hope we can work on this, the infrastructure for water resources and the other things that are needed for stability in order to, like you say, move forward. So
I agree with you, Senator.
Yeah, appreciate that. Thank you for your courtesies, Mr. Chairman. I know I ran over a little bit.
You certainly did.
Looks like, I bow down and apologize to you.
There will be war. That's right.
Senator Barrasso, so patient, and I'm sorry I passed you over earlier, but thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ambassador Tueller, if I could, just a general impression, how extensive is Iran's influence over Iraq?
Well, of course, the two countries share a long border. They share economic history, family, religious ties. But I think it's often missed as you look at the broader to understand, again, as I said, Iraqi nationalism, the fact that Iraqi Shia clergy have their own standing, credibility, legitimacy within the country. So I think it's important not to overstate or to overreact to what is Iran's presence and relationship. I would say we are not trying to sever the relationship between Iraq and Iran. There should be. What we want to see is a normal, healthy relationship based on respect for sovereignty, and Iraq wanting to build as we want to build, an Iraq that's Iran wanting to build an Iraq that's strong, stable, and sovereign.
Because I'm thinking in terms about the Iran, they have armed militias who provided Revolutionary Guard forces to assist with the fighting against ISIS in Iraq. So I'm looking about the current role the Iranian forces are playing in Iraq, and you know what you see in terms of the force activity there.
Senator, the issue of the popular mobilization forces that exist in Iran is one that's complicated. I know that the Prime Minister and other government officials are trying to bring all of those forces under the control of the government. Many of those forces, in fact, are nominally under the control of the Prime Minister. What we're really concerned about is particularly those popular mobilization forces that are not responsive to the Iraqi government, but are taking their directions, their leadership from not just Iran, but from the Iranian Quds, Revolutionary Quds Force. And that is what is going to pose a great challenge, I think, moving forward. For Iraq to emerge as a strong, sovereign, normal country, it has to deal with that issue.
You know, the United States has been encouraging Iraq to end its energy dependence on Iran. There's a Wall Street Journal article from November headlining U.S. pushes Iraq to wean itself off Iranian energy. But despite its role as a major energy producer itself, Iraq, it does rely on Iran for imported natural gas to use in gas turbine power plants. Iranian natural gas generates about 45% of Iraq's electricity. Upon the reimposition of U.S. sanctions against Iran, the United States has provided Iraq a couple of waivers. So I'm just thinking, do you believe Iraq is serious about ending its dependence on Iran for energy, and what efforts, you know, is Iraq taking to reduce or end its energy dependence on Iran?
Senator, it's correct, not only in, the significant imports of natural gas from Iran, but also electricity itself as part of the grid. So it's important, for example, that Iraq receive capital, improve its ability to capture its own natural gas rather than flaring it so that it can be used to generate electricity. In the last several months, there has been some progress in that respect, but it's time-consuming, not enough as happened yet. And I think an important thing to try to use as, if I'm confirmed and as ambassador, to encourage U.S. companies to be able to play a role in helping the Iraqi energy sector to capture that natural gas to use it for electrical generation.
And then less dependent upon Iran for that sources of energy. Thank you. General, if I could, just the blockade with Qatar, in June of 2017, Saudi Arabia ended the diplomatic relationships with Qatar, and Saudi Arabia led a blockade against Qatar in terms of its Arab Gulf neighbors, Egypt, UAE, Bahrain. You know all of the things that have happened there. Can you talk a little bit about what the current status is of this dispute with Saudi Arabia and Qatar, and what progress has been there in terms of resolving the dispute?
To be honest, Senator, I don't think there's been much progress in resolving the dispute. I know there have been some forums, especially in the defense arena, where Qatari representatives were allowed to attend opportunities to meet with their Gulf colleagues. My opinion is that it's important to solve this problem, having Gulf states be antagonistic and at each other's throats at a time when they're facing a great threat from Iran, to me, doesn't make geopolitical sense.
Well, to that point that you just made, can you talk about how this dispute threatens the regional unity needed to counter Iran?
Senator, the Iranians are masters at finding the small crack between forces of that they face. And they have a small crack because of this dispute.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator. Ambassador Tueller, I think Senator Barrasso has raised about the Iranian influence in Iraq is a really serious concern to all of us. We keep hearing more and more reports of that, not only in this committee, but other committees that I serve on. And I hope you'll pay close attention to it. We all know their malign intent, and we realize it's complicated, like you said, but discouraging to hear the inroads they continue to make into the Iraqi infrastructure. So in any event, I hope you keep an eye on that. Senator Menendez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Abizaid, I'm very inclined to support your nomination, but I heard a few answers here that create a little cause of concern for me, so let me try to follow up with you. In several answers, you said we can't afford, and went on to describe elements that we can't afford Saudi Arabia not to do X, Y, or Z. From my perspective, we can't afford to continue to allow the Saudis fighting in Yemen and indiscriminately bombing civilians and ultimately violating international law. We can't afford to allow the killing of an American resident journalist with impunity and no consequence for that. We can't afford to allow U.S. citizens or permanent residents to be detained and, if some of these allegations are true, tortured without consequence. And the list goes on. So yes, many of us understand that the Saudi relationship is important in our broader national security question, particularly as it relates to Iran. But that doesn't mean, that does not mean that we cannot challenge our relationship with a nation, even when our security interests may align. Is that your view, that we can challenge and seek to change the nature of the relationship, or is it that we have to accept what they have done in order to pursue our greater national security goals?
Senator, I thought I was clear in saying we should not accept these outrageous sorts of problems, such as the killing of Jamal Khashoggi, that we shouldn't accept the torture and detention, the alleged torture and detention of an American citizen, and so many other things, as I mentioned in my opening statement. These short-term problems have to be solved now, and it requires forceful discussions on the behalf of the United States with the government of Saudi Arabia. And I am prepared to have those discussions if you confirm me.
All right, well, because that's important, because I get concerned that somehow we create this aura that the relationship is so important that we cannot challenge those things that are horribly wrong about it. And I don't buy that. Because if at the end of the day you can kill a journalist with impunity, and because of our interests, we'll look the other way, that is a dangerous message to send across the globe. And it is a dangerous message to send to any other country for which we may have an interest, that you can act with impunity as long as you pursue a certain interest we might have with you. That is not who we are as a nation. I just want to make sure you're going to have no problem pursuing those challenges.
I have no problem saying what I need to say now, in that regard.
And in that regard, will you press the Saudi government on the continued detention of American citizen Dr. Waleed Fatahi?
Yes.
And will you commit to request to visit women rights activists who've been unjustly detained?
Yes.
All right, and finally, let me turn, and Ambassador Tull, I don't want you to think I have no affection for you in this hearing. So let me just ask you, what does success look like for us in Iraq? And how do we achieve that?
and what tools do we have to try to achieve it? I succinctly give me a sense of that. It's a broad statement of your message, of your mission, I should say, but I'd like to get a sense of what it is that we are working towards.
Sir, I believe we do need to be guided by a long-term strategic vision, and I think it's a vision that sees Iraq as a pillar of stability in the region. And we achieve that by working with Iraqis to build up their security institutions, by building up their economy, by combating the influence of sectarianism, by combating issues like corruption or lack of transparency in the economy. We seek that as a vision, whereas you look at the contrasting agenda of Iran, which seeks an Iraq that's weak, that's divided, that doesn't have sovereignty over its own territory and forces. We are working to bring about in areas of Iraq clean drinking water and government services to people, where Iran is flooding the market with cheap goods and, in fact, even with heroin or other dangerous products. So we need to be projecting a positive, constructive vision for Iraq, and I have no problem doing
that. And what's our leverage to achieve those things?
Again, I think that we have allies and partners who want that, Iraqis who want that same vision, and working with them, whether they're from Kurds, whether they're from political alliances, wherever they come from, those Iraqis that want to see a strong, stable, unified, sovereign Iraq, those are the people that we will work with.
Thank you.
Thank you. We hear a lot of partisan talk up here, but so there is no mistake. I think the ranking member probably articulated as clearly as it's possible that when we have an ally, we try to support those allies as best we can, but the kinds of things that have been happening lately make it very, very difficult, and we cannot look the other way. Thank you for those remarks, Senator Menendez. Senator Murphy.
Thank you very much. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to have a short second round. Appreciate, General Abizaid, your follow-up answer to Senator Menendez. I, as well, was a bit concerned with what was, to me, an unexpected, robust defense at times of the Saudi regime, so I appreciate your clarification. My second round, though, is for you, Mr. Tueller. The Houthis no doubt bear significant responsibility for the humanitarian catastrophe up until this day. But you are the first diplomat with jurisdiction over the crisis in Yemen that I have ever heard assign 0% responsibility for the humanitarian disaster inside Yemen to the Saudis. And it seemed as if you resisted amending that answer in the follow-up from Senator Merkley. And although Senator Young didn't ask you a question, I think you understood the beginning of his query to you. Just because one party starts a war does not give carte blanche to the other side to conduct themselves in a manner that makes the humanitarian situation on the ground worse. And by saying that the Saudis bear no responsibility for what has happened there is a permission slip to the Saudis and anyone who's a contestant to a conflict to behave as irresponsibly as they like just because they might not have been the instigator. I can recite you the same statistics that Senator Merkley did, but they're pretty overwhelming in terms of the consensus among the international community as to the effect that the bombing campaign targeting civilians, the months-long blockade, had on the worsening humanitarian situation. So I want to give you one last shot before we end here to amend your answer that the Saudis, that the Houthis bear 100% responsibility for the civilian nightmare that has happened inside Yemen.
Mr. Senator, thank you for the follow-on question. And in describing what I think is an analytical position as to exactly what is happening to the economy in Yemen, that does in no way or shape excuse the Saudis when they violate the arm of long armed conflict or conduct their military operations in a manner that doesn't give due regard for civilian life. What I'm describing, however, is a situation in Yemen, already the poorest country in the world with measures of childhood stunting, famine that existed before 2014, that has absolutely had the economy, the legs of the economy kicked out from under it by the actions of the Houthis and the Iranian-backed proxies. The UN humanitarian coordinator, I think, has described the situation best when she said, Yemen is not suffering from a famine of food. Yemen is suffering from a famine of incomes. That is what is really driving most of the humanitarian suffering that we're all witnessing. Yemenis who have lost their incomes because of closure of private sector, small and medium enterprises, who have lost their government salaries, the government that's lost its income from
I get it. I get it. That's not my question. I understand what's happening there. The question is whether the Saudis bear something above 0% responsibility for what has happened there.
Senator, I understand, and absolutely, I wouldn't minimize that when there have been targeting of infrastructure such as roads or bridges or transportation, and that has had a very, very deleterious impact on the economy. But if you're looking for a solution of how we're going to address the humanitarian situation, it's going to be able to find a way to leverage the Houthis into entering into a peaceful power-sharing agreement. It's not going to happen as a result of what the Saudis will do. The answers lie in the hands of the Yemenis. And, sir, I think many, many Yemenis would tell you exactly the same thing that I've said here today.
So are you not so help me figure this out. Are you changing your answer or not changing your answer? Because this is a problem for you moving forward here. If you can't commit to us that the Saudis have some responsibility for what's happened there, as almost everyone who's testified before this committee, before you, has said. Are you changing your answer or not?
Sir, with the war going on, and of course the Saudis is one of the participants, absolutely, of course, they have had an impact on the humanitarian suffering. I'm not saying that. And I think, again, going to the specific question, when there have been violations of the law of armed conflict or undue consideration for collateral damage, we cannot overlook that or excuse that. But, sir, when I'm looking for answers of how we are going to, as a nation, resolve the humanitarian crisis, we've got to look to the underlying causes of what's happening in Yemen, the responsibility of all the Yemeni parties, and what we're going to do so that the Yemeni civilians don't continue this suffering.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator. Well, with that, thank you to both of you and your families. You've been very patient with us, and we really appreciate that. For information of the members, the record will remain open until close of business on Thursday, including for members to submit questions for the record. With the thanks of the committee, this hearing is now adjourned.
I'm feeding back a press conference, and you see a podium on CBNG 13? All right, if you could kindly start rolling, it's about to start in 2 minutes. Give me an hour, please. The desk said something about a Bloom law firm lawsuit. All right, thanks. Thanks, Janet. Stand by. Did you get the cutaway?
Yeah.
Thank you. You're going to have to translate to Spanish. You don't have any chairs.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Attorney Lisa Bloom, and I'm here today with my client, Detective Isabel Villegas. Ms. Villegas will read a short prepared statement. I will read a statement as well, and then we're happy to answer questions. Ms. Villegas?
I'm Isabel Villegas, a detective with the LAPD. I've been a faithful, exemplary employee for nearly 30 years. My file is full of commendations, and I have an unblemished record. I was previously assigned to Robbery Homicide Division. In 2013, Officer Danny Reedy pursued me and we became involved in a consensual relationship. Reedy became abusive. Reedy took intimate photos of me without my permission. I repeatedly asked that he delete these photos. Instead, Reedy threatened to make these photos public to the LAPD to humiliate me, and ruin my career. He threatened to spread horrible rumors about me that were false. Reedy harassed me at work, and he sent these intimate photos to my work email. He also sent these photos to my coworkers. With these photos, he emotionally terrorized me. He controlled and manipulated me. When the pictures went viral, LAPD management did nothing. They didn't publish an order or notice to provide directions to the commanding officers regarding what actions to take or how to cease the proliferation of these pictures. When the rumors were rampant, they did nothing to stop them. When I came forward to Internal Affairs, I was transferred from the prestigious Robbery Homicide Division, and assigned to Northeast Detective Division. I should not have been reassigned, given I was a victim. This transfer, this action, was retaliatory. Although a judge granted a 5-year domestic violence restraining order against Reedy with a firearm restriction, he is still employed and he is still receiving pay. One of the things that hurts so much is that my LAPD family has turned his back against me. To this date, I have not been contacted by phone, email, or text by any LAPD manager to offer me anything. No counseling, witness protection detail, threat assessment, or simply to check to see how I am doing. LAPD management has abandoned me. This lack of compassion shows me that LAPD doesn't care about its victims of sexual harassment or hostile work environment. Thank you, Isabel. My name is Attorney Lisa Bloom, and I'm very proud today to represent Detective Villegas as we take the next step in our fight for justice for her. My Bloom firm attorneys Vernon Ellicott, Franklin Ferguson, and Serena Terzian are also part of the litigation team on this case. It's not easy to be a woman in law enforcement. It is still a very male-dominated field and too often still with a frat boy culture. Very few women make it to the top. But Detective Villegas did through hard work and many years of commendations and doing a great job. She is the kind of detective we want in this city, that I want protecting me and my family. Unfortunately, she's now out on a stress leave, broken and humiliated because the LAPD failed and refused to protect her. On January 15th, Ms. Villegas and I and my team went to court and we won a sweeping 5-year restraining order against Officer Reedy. He is now prohibited from contacting her by any means. He is prohibited from possessing or distributing explicit photos of her, and he is prohibited from possessing a firearm, which obviously severely hampers his ability to be an LAPD officer. And yet he remains on payroll, getting full pay, and as far as we know, Internal Affairs has not gotten rid of him, as they should have by now. So the restraining order that we got is not enough. Every California employer has a legal obligation to take all reasonable steps to prevent sexual harassment of its workers, regardless of who is doing the harassing. Isabel Villegas alleges in the complaint that we filed yesterday that she told multiple LAPD officers, including supervisors, that Officer Reedy was physically abusing her and that he was threatening to release explicit photos of her if she ended the relationship. No one investigated. No one stopped him. And so, of course, emboldened and enabled, ultimately, that's what he did. He released those photos. Revenge porn is a very sick, brutal way to humiliate someone, and that someone is almost always a woman. Her right to sexual privacy is cruelly violated. Many girls and women have said that they contemplated suicide after revenge porn photos were released, and in fact, sadly, some women and girls have committed suicide after being victims of revenge porn. I know that Detective Villegas felt very dark and very sad after this happened to her. Isabel, I want you to know you have done nothing wrong. You have no reason to be embarrassed, and you're very brave to stand up today. And any girls and women who are watching, I hope you follow her lead, that you have nothing to be ashamed of, and you have every right to stand up for yourself, and I hope you will do that as well. So we filed this lawsuit to demand accountability, not just from Officer Reedy, but from the LAPD and the city of Los Angeles, my city. This state, California, has very strong revenge porn laws, but they are useless if they are not enforced by our own law enforcement agencies. LAPD officers are required to report known misconduct among
you get here at 5 a.m. to get that?
I'm a New Yorker. I know it's
I guess it's still morning, is it? Seems like we've been here a long time already today. Maria? Right here. Oh, okay, right next to you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here, and I especially want to welcome our friends who are so helpful in terms of this issue, in terms of the outside mobilization for a free internet. I'm so pleased to welcome some of our friends over from the Senate, many who started in the Congress of the United States in the House of Representatives. Leader Schumer, Senator Markey, Senator Cantwell, and Senator Wyden. Welcome, and thank you for your leadership. I want to, we'll be hearing from some of our members, Representative Doyle, leader on this issue, and chairman of the Subcommittee on Energy and Commerce that deals with net neutrality, the chairman of the committee, Frank Pallone. Thank you, Mr. Pallone, for being here. Rep. Clark, vice chair of the committee, who's here to speak on this subject. And I particularly want to acknowledge Congresswoman Anna Eshoo, who has been the godmother of this issue for so many years when she was chair, a ranking member of the committee that Mr. Doyle now chairs. Thank you, Congresswoman Eshoo, for your extraordinary leadership on this. Again, it's an honor to be with members of Congress from both sides of the Capitol to save the internet. We salute Representative Mike Doyle, Mr. Chairman, for his relentless leadership to protect net neutrality. We are thrilled to be with so many advocates across the country. Millions of Americans are organized, mobilized, and they made the difference in the fights that we've had. Mr. Markey's CRA in the Senate last year, but even before that, under Congresswoman Eshoo's leadership, the issue to speak out in terms of what the Federal Communications Commission was doing. Young people in particular get it. This is about your jobs and your future. So the free and open internet is a pillar of so many things, our democracy, our economic possibilities, entrepreneurship, and the rest, creating opportunities and empowering communities. A full 86% of Americans opposed the Trump assault on net neutrality, including 82% of Republicans. That's hopeful. With the Save the Internet Act, Democrats are honoring the will of the people and restoring the protections that do this. Stop unjust, discriminatory practices by ISPs that try to throttle the public's browsing speed, block your internet access, and increase your costs. This is about freedom. It's about cost. Giving entrepreneurs and small businesses a level playing field and ensuring American innovation can continue to be the envy of the world. This legislation also brings the power of the internet to every corner of the country, from rural America to our cities. We must close the urban-rural digital divide, guaranteeing better, cheaper internet so that we can create jobs and unlock the economic potential for all. Rural areas, inner cities, for all. Supporting this bill means supporting our democracy, ensuring that the voices of the public are heard, their will is respected, and the internet remains free and open to all. We call on our Republican colleagues, and many Republicans in the country support this legislation and have in the United States Senate already, to join in supporting us by restoring net neutrality. With that, I'm very pleased once again, on many occasions, I've had the honor of welcoming back to the House of Representatives our former colleague, a source of pride to all of us who served with him, the Democratic leader of the Senate, Mr. Schumer.
Thank you, Leader Pelosi, and I'd like to thank all of my Senate colleagues, our House colleagues. None of the House colleagues have served in the Senate. We did our service with you.
We did have one, Claude Pepper.
Claude Pepper. Yes, we had Claude Pepper. Yes.
Nobody.
Anyone know who he is? I spoke to the young Democrats in Manhattan and mentioned Bella Abzug, and they said, who? Shows you. Anyway.
This will be our fate.
So anyway, I want to thank all of my colleagues for being here, the advocates, business leaders, and everyday working Americans, making their voices heard. Saving the internet has been a grassroots effort, if there ever was one, because average folks understand that they do not want their costs of using the internet to go up. They do not want their freedom to be constricted. If they should decide to start up a business, they want to be on an equal playing field with the big boys. There are so many reasons that we need net neutrality. You know, when we don't let electric companies, also a monopoly, say you can charge this house one rate and the same house next door another rate. We don't let our highways, even when they're privatized, say you can charge this car one rate, you can charge that car another. We need the same rules on the internet. It's got to be open and free and fair. It's got to give the average person a break. And last spring, our colleagues in the United States Senate were given that choice to side with the average person rather than the big special interests, to side with protecting middle-class families and consumers and entrepreneurs rather than those, the big boys. Unfortunately, all but three Senate Republicans voted on behalf of the special interests. But Democrats voted on behalf of the American people, who have been calling and writing and texting and tweeting and posting, urging the Senate to pass legislation to undo the FCC's horrible decision. Believe it or not, it passed the Senate. It did, because of the hard work of my colleagues who were standing here. But unfortunately, a Republican-led House of Representatives just shelved it. So now we have a Democratic House, and Republicans will have a second chance. There are second chances to right the Trump administration's wrong. You can bet that Democrats will continue to side with hardworking Americans who pay their cell phone bills, pay their internet bills each month. Republicans should join us instead of siding with the executives at the big broadband providers who send out the bills. And this is a real bipartisan effort to right the administration's wrong and protect the free and open internet. We say to the millions of Americans who care about this, continue to let your representatives and your senators know how you feel, because your power, with your power behind us, we can succeed. Thank you. And now it is my honor to call on a great Congress member from the neighboring state and a great Steelers fan, Representative Doyle.
Thank you. This is a great morning, and I'm very happy to be here with our Speaker and Leader Schumer, Chairman Pallone, Ranking Member Cantwell, and all the other members you see behind us in supporting us. I also want to thank my partner, Ed Markey, in this endeavor, and my dear friend and colleague, Anna Eshoo, who for many years has championed this issue. Thanks, Anna. We've been working on this issue for a long time. We all believe very strongly in the promise and necessity of a free and open internet, and we've worked hard for more than a decade to see that vision come to fruition. We're here today to announce the Save the Internet Act, legislation which restores popular, bipartisan, common sense net neutrality protections and puts a cop back on the beat to protect consumers, small businesses, and competitors from unjust and unreasonable practices by internet service providers. The Save the Internet Act would enact true net neutrality protections by codifying the FCC's 2015 Open Internet Order as a new freestanding section of law that would ensure the internet remains an open platform for innovation and competition. Net neutrality is one of the most important digital rights issues we face today, and the internet is among the most influential and important inventions ever created. Today, it touches almost all aspects of our economy, culture, and politics. And Americans around the country overwhelmingly support strong net neutrality rules on a bipartisan basis. People understand that their ISPs have far too much control over their connection to the internet and the services that they care about. So whether it's slowing down Netflix, blocking access to innovative mobile services, or adopting anti-competitive zero rating policies, the track record for ISPs on this issue is clear. And consumers and small businesses want the protections and the certainty that strong net neutrality rules provide. I'm proud to be introducing this bill along with Senator Markey, who has been a champion for free and open internet. Together, we hope to advance this legislation through the Congress and restore these essential protections for all Americans. And it's now my great pleasure. Oh, and I also want to also mention we have many, many participating organizations that have worked hard with us throughout the years for this and continue to work for it. The Center for Media Justice, Color of Change, Consumer Reports, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, Free Press, the National Hispanic Media Coalition, Open Tech Institute, and Public Knowledge. All of these organizations have been working tirelessly over the last decade to bring bipartisan net neutrality rules back to consumers and small businesses, and we thank them all for their participation. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce a former House member and my colleague, Ed Markey.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Michael, so much. Thank you for your incredible leadership on this issue. Thank you to our great leaders, Speaker Pelosi, Leader Schumer, and to Frank Pallone, and to Maria Cantwell, to Yvette Clark, to Ron Wyden, to all the groups who are out here, and back to the beginning of recorded internet time to Anna Eshoo for all of her work on this issue there from the beginning of time. So we have a internet time. Internet time.
That would be 30 years.
Whether it is in the halls of Congress or in the courts, we will not stop fighting until net neutrality is fully restored. Today we take another important step in that fight. The fight to save the internet as we know it. A fight for innovation, for entrepreneurialism, for the American economy. A fight for free speech, the cornerstone of our democracy. The fight for net neutrality. And it is a fight that we can win, because another way of saying net neutrality is non-discrimination against the smallest companies, against the smallest voices within our society. We are standing and fighting for them here today, and we will not stop until we win. Last year, in an historic bipartisan CRA vote of 52-47 in the Senate, we sent a message to President Trump about what a free and open internet means. Free of corporate control, open to all who want to communicate, engage, and innovate. This bill does what the American people want. It returns us to the rules that ensures that they are not subject to higher prices or slower internet speeds or even blocked websites because the big broadband providers want to pump up their profits. Nearly every single member of the Senate Democratic Caucus is a co-sponsor of our new legislation, the Save the Internet Act. Last year, we sent a message on net neutrality to Donald Trump, and today we send another. This Congress won't fall to his special interest agenda and his broadband baron allies. Instead, we will do right by the people who sent us here and protect the internet as we know it. We are on the right side of history. And we will not give up this fight. It begins today, and this coalition will not stop until we win. So let me now turn introduce the chairman of the House Energy and Commerce Committee, my great friend Frank Pallone.
Thank you, Senator. I just want to, I can't emphasize enough how important this is, and that's why I'm so pleased that all of our colleagues and our House and Senate leadership are here joining us today. We use the term Save the Internet Act, but you know, again, the internet, we're not talking about a machine, we're not talking about a piece of equipment, we're talking about what the country stands for. And so when we talk about saving the internet, we're talking about saving the marketplace. We're talking about saving our democracy. It's that important an issue, net neutrality. And just as a few examples, you know, I know that when we were going around, when the FCC decided to repeal net neutrality and hearing all these voices at home, you know, I would hear from small business who said that the only reason I was successful with my small business was because of the free and open internet. Or I remember going on a relatively conservative talk show, and they were concerned about the ideology, about how, you know, conservative voices might be shut out if we don't have net neutrality. Or people, I remember going to the public library in my hometown, where people were going there to, you know, look for a job, and that was their way of, you know, it's the way young people, many people now, actually find a job, and concerned that if we eliminated net neutrality, they would have a harder time finding a job. So this is so important in terms of our democracy, innovation, all the things that my colleagues have talked about. But the second thing I wanted to mention briefly, because Nancy Pelosi mentioned the will of the people. I believe very strongly that the way the FCC proceeded in repealing net neutrality was just totally contrary to the will of the people. You know, the FCC is supposed to be an independent agency, and they were under previous administrations, but they are not now. Chairman Pai and spokespeople for President Trump made it quite clear before they even started to have hearings on this repeal rule that they were going to repeal net neutrality. 24 million people wrote to the FCC or contacted the FCC and said, do not repeal net neutrality, and they completely ignored them. They had made up their mind from the beginning, and that's not the way they're supposed to proceed. So I am so pleased today that we're moving ahead, and we're going to guarantee in the Energy and Commerce Committee that we move quickly on this legislation to save the internet because of its importance. And now I want to yield to my colleague from the Senate, again, a member of the House that we're so pleased to work with, Maria Cantwell.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here with my colleagues, Speaker Pelosi, Leader Schumer, Representative Doyle, Senators Markey, Representative Plon. I look forward to working with you on a whole myriad of issues in the Commerce Committee. Obviously, Representative Clark, Senator Wyden, and so many of our colleagues behind us. Nancy Pelosi becoming Speaker and taking over the House of Representatives has breathed new life into the battle for an open internet. We applaud that our colleagues have been able to now bring focus, and I'm going to introduce Representative Clark in a minute, who is busy whipping members to support this legislation. But I think we're going to find out, as we already did in the Senate, that we're pretty unified on our side of the aisle, that we believe that protecting consumers from price gouging on the internet, a vital tool for communication today, is essential. And while we were able to gain bipartisan support in the United States Senate, we hope that this large-scale debate in the House of Representatives will also gain some bipartisan support and the attention of the American public so we can continue. 5 states now have laws on net neutrality, and some of them have been passing legislation in bipartisan fashion. I think there's another 30 states that are considering this legislation, ideas of protecting the internet. So it's accurate to say the debate about an open internet is not going away. In fact, it just got a few more logs thrown on the fire. Why is this so critical? Many of my colleagues already mentioned why it's so critical for people just not to be gouged by their cable companies. And obviously, I think everybody in this room can have a little bit of empathy for that. But it is also important for an internet economy as next generation businesses come along. Whether that is in the area of online medicine, or God forbid, an emergency room that just can't get an x-ray in time because they didn't pay for a fast lane, or whether that's a college student studying in their dorm room who also get throttled back at a key time that they need to study for the final exam. Getting access to information is life-saving and critical for businesses. And so we stand today for the innovation economy that represents more than $1 billion already, and how important it is for them not to be throttled back by somebody who gets to make arbitrary decisions about access to broadband. So I hope our colleagues in the House will be loud and proud of this legislation. We look forward to seeing how we can help in getting it passed in the United States Senate. And now I turn it over to my colleague, Representative Clark.
Thank you very much, Senator, and let me thank the leadership you see assembled here, as well as my colleagues and the advocates, for being here as we announce to you that we are here to save the internet. Save the internet for today, tomorrow, and for future generations. The Republican FCC has dismantled net neutrality, saddling consumers with higher costs and less choice, throttling competition and punishing entrepreneurs, small businesses, communities of color, and other Americans who are vulnerable and disenfranchised. This is the 21st century issue of equity. And what we are saying here today is that we will not allow our internet to be taken over by those who would profit at the expense of our values for democracy, First Amendment rights, entrepreneurship, and innovation. Democrats promised to restore open, unrestricted access to the internet and build out high-speed internet for every community across this nation, be they rural, be they towns, be they small cities, be they schools or businesses. America is still waiting for it. Today, we are keeping our promise to the American people, as has already been stated, and we are proud to announce the introduction of the Save the Internet Act. Here's what we know. As prices go up and flexibility use drops, the impact will be felt by most of those with less money to spend on preserving internet access. People like my constituents in Brownsville, Brooklyn, reducing effective internet access has a profound impact on low to moderate income individuals. Government services at all levels are increasingly moving online. If you struggle with multiple jobs or the travel time through public transit necessary to get to government offices, reducing access to the internet means reducing access to vital services. Additionally, internet access has become critically important to finding jobs, as has already been stated by Senator Cantwell. According to the Pew Research Center, and for many, smartphones are dominating how folks actually hunt for jobs. Finding work without adequate online access is frankly difficult. Lastly, if you have young children, you know that internet access is virtually mandatory at school, work, and at play. Whether to do research, gain access to course materials, and more. The bill we are introducing today would make life easier for my constituents in Brownsville, Brooklyn. The Save the Internet Act creates popular, bipartisan, and targeted net neutrality protections and places a cop on the beat to protect consumers, small businesses, and competition from abusive practices of internet service providers. This act mirrors the similar bipartisan Congressional Review Act legislation that passed the Senate last Congress and has had 182 bipartisan signers on the discharge petition in the House. So I will be whipping. The majority of Americans oppose the FCC's rollback of the same protections that would be enacted by the Save the Internet Act. The Save the Internet Act would revive necessary common sense provisions for defending the internet while stopping the FCC from applying more than 700 regulations under the Communications Act that are unnecessary to protecting an open internet, such as rate setting. And we would enact true net neutrality protections without loopholes that are designed for today and tomorrow. I've heard from hundreds of my constituents across the breadth and depth of my district, and their message is clear, our message is clear. It is time for net neutrality. It is time for the Save the Internet Act. Having said that, I now yield to the gentleman, Senator Wyden.
Thank you. And after a basketball game, my mother would always say, "Dear, make sure you're running with the right crowd." I'm looking around here. I am running with the best crowd. And I want to thank them all for making this event possible. I'm just going to make a quick comment before I have the honor of throwing it to our outstanding speaker, Speaker Pelosi, for our wrap-up.
Yesterday, Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the World Wide Web, came in for a little chat, just a visit. And the very first point he brought up was the urgency of protecting net neutrality. That's because without net neutrality, special interests can upend the free and open internet and decide that even after you pay your internet access fee, you can't go where you want, when you want, and how you want online. Now, we've all been talking about how this battle started shortly after the Earth cooled. And just one little bit of personal history. Eddie Markey introduced the first net neutrality bill in the House. I wrote the first one in the Senate when I had a full head of hair and rugged good looks. And the reason all of us have been in this together, Anna Eshoo represented my late mom in Palo Alto. The reason all of us have been in this is because of our belief that the big cable companies should not be able to pick and choose which videos you get to watch or which articles you can read by favoring one outlet over another. And to make sure that doesn't happen, Congress has to pass the Save the Internet Act. And I am happy to throw this now for closing to our outstanding speaker, my friend, former neighbor in the House, Speaker Nancy Pelosi.
Thank you, Senator Wyden. I just wonder if your mother's influence in Anna's district encouraged her to run with the right crowd. I thank all of our participants here today. I want to acknowledge that Elliot Engel, we know him as the chair of the Foreign Affairs Committee, but he is also a member of the Energy and Commerce Committee. Debbie Dingell was just with us until a moment ago. I think she had to go to the floor. Doris Matsui is here of California, a member of the committee. Jerry McNerney of California, a member of the committee. I say that with pride, Mr. Chairman, because California has passed a net neutrality, as well as a privacy bill on the internet as well. So I thank them for their leadership, all of them, for being here, and join Chairman Doyle in acknowledging the participating organizations. The outside mobilization will be essential to the success that we have. Our inside maneuvering important. And what will that be? Mr. Chairman Doyle will be having hearings on this legislation imminently.
Next week.
Following that, a markup of the bill. And then following that, a markup in full committee under leadership of Mr. Pallone. Following that, the bill will come to the floor. So in a matter of weeks, we will act upon this. And I thank Senator Cantwell for her kind remarks, but it's about the Democratic majority that has made the difference. However, we want this to be as bipartisan as possible because we know it is so in the public view. Anna has given us some instructions over our shoulders. I don't know if she wanted to weigh in for a moment about this.
I think this effort has been very well explained this morning, but I think that there's something that needs to be noted. This is a two-page bill. A two-page bill. It has all the clarity in the world. There should not be any excuses on the part of any member of Congress because this has full clarity. It was tested in the courts and won each time. And so what is in this bill is our Declaration of Independence of the big boys. And that's what it is, and I look forward to its passage. Yes, and I'd also like to acknowledge that the outstanding commissioner from the FCC, Jessica Rosenworcel, is here, and we're so proud of her service and her fight at the FCC. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, you very much to all of our participants here. At one stage or another, they will be weighing in, and we would just like to remind the chairman of the FCC to hear the voices of the 24 million people who wrote in a louder way than he hears the voice of his former employer. With that, we thank all of you for coming. Upward and onward, thank you to all the participants for saving the internet. I too had a visit for Sir Tim yesterday, 30 years since he invented the World Wide Web. I said, how are we doing? So while in the first couple of decades it was really free and open, now we have to make sure it continues to be, not only from the ISFs, but T's, but also from what the impact is of algorithms and the rest to decide what goes forward. We want it free, we want it open, we want it democratic, and we want it low cost for everyone. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Jewish mom told me.